to abide by those standards. It's a set of standards. It doesn't say that UNHCR becomes the authority for refugee status determination. So just that clarification. But like Sir said, I think the second panel is better suited to answering the very big question of why India hasn't signed the convention, if there is an answer. Thank you.
Good morning to all the panelists. My name is Ankit Kapoor. I'm a first year law student at NLS. So my question is more with regards to the political context with which the refugee discourse takes place, wherein we need to realize that the power structure that has control over the narrative is the Hindutva populism, right? And this viewed along with the absence of a proper liberal narrative, wherein the opposition that we have is very weak, along with an incoherent migration policy that you've mentioned. So in relation to all of this, it's very evident that the legislature or the executive cannot act as the custodian of refugee rights. So the onus of this then falls onto the judiciary, right? And taking historical precedence of judicial activism in the form of the Vishakha guidelines or even Bhim Singh for that matter, how legitimate and important do you think judicial activism in the course of refugee rights is?
Can we have a couple of other questions? We can answer those then. I think largely for those of you who are still here in the second session is actually a better forum for discussing anything to do with refugee rights specifically, because this panel was more on migration. There are very, very experienced and esteemed panelists on the second session, so you could ask them.
No, but just to a quick response, I think it's very important. Judicial activism is going to be extremely important, not just with the current narrative or the current regime, but always. I mean, judicial activism, I think, is important to hold the state to account. And I think it'll always have an important role to play.
And having said that, let's not discount the legislature and the executive just yet. We still have a very functioning legislative and executive authority. So whatever it is, the executive is always going to be bound by political considerations. That's standard for all countries. And so is the legislature. We are voting those people in. So they are making, there is a bill in parliament called the Asylum Bill since 2015. So work is being done. Response is always a matter of time and a matter of, in the end, public opinion. So public opinion influences a lot more legislative and executive and even judicial discourse and action than we give it credit.
Hello, my name is Aman Garg. I'm a first year student at NLS as well. So my question is to Sita, ma'am. Ma'am, you mentioned in your inaugural statements that workers, rather than taking up the jobs, fill up the jobs that the people do not want. But in the Indian context, when we see that the interstate migration is there as well, when people from so-called backward states such as Bihar fill up spaces of employment in the blue-collar jobs as such. So do you think that it is right to say that there is a space for migrants to fill up those jobs when we have interstate migration on a rise as well?
Okay, firstly, as far as interstate migration is concerned, I don't think we should discriminate between migrant or non-migrant because they're all Indians at the end of the day. So everyone has a right to any job in any state. It is not, these are not the boundaries that should exist anyway. They do exist in some ways because social protection doesn't move the way people move. But having said that, no, the truth is, and like I was trying to show you through that example, the migrants do take often the lowest jobs. They do often take jobs that people don't want to take or are not willing to take because not because of the job, but maybe because of the quality of the job, the wages the job offers, or whatever it may be. So very often it is that. And as Mr. Gurucharan was saying, there are intermediaries in this. I don't know if you are aware, but I was very taken aback, and this is of course an international example, but there were companies, construction companies, for example, in Qatar, that were actually getting workers to pay not just for their employment, which was all the recruitment costs, but also for some of the other costs, because they were charging them so much to take that job itself. So the role of intermediaries and the fact that they come into play, particularly when there is the movement of people, happens to actually undercut and undermine further these jobs, which means that if a local would have taken that job, it's just that the quality of the job decreases so much that nobody wants to actually take that job anymore. And then the migrant does take that job because, like I'd earlier said, the migrant actually either is stuck with an intermediary, doesn't have a choice anyway, or is somebody who's so desperate is willing to go, you know, to that lowest level, and the race to the bottom just continues with these migrants.
Good morning. My name is Shantanu. I'm from National Law School, Bangalore. And my question is to Gurcharan sir, because he has been in the government for many years. He has a ringside view of the whole governance issues which the government deals with. We talk of the migration policy as an institutionalized stigma, and that is the topic. The issue becomes problematic, according to me, because we see a very skewed distribution of the migrants across the country. Like if you talk about the Rohingyas, we generally read throughout that there are 10,000 or this much number in Jammu Kashmir. We have 29 states. We can use our diversity. We can use our geographical expense. Because the local communities, they are actually feeling, or the backlash is because of the competing class mobilization. If there are more and more number of Bangladeshis in Assam, then the locals there feel that they are being threatened. If the more number is there, if the more influx is there, and we can evenly distribute them through a policy, don't you think that the problem automatically fades away? It cannot be a problem for a country like India. It can be a problem for a country like Germany. It can be a problem for a country like France, which are relatively much smaller compared to us. But if we look at this uniform spatial distribution, don't you think that the problem automatically fades away?
I agree.
Any more questions? There's one here. Yeah.
Good morning, ma'am. My question is addressed to Ms. Sita Sharma. I'm Aditya Falnekar. I'm also from NLS. You mentioned when you were speaking here that there's an argument, and you see this argument in America as well as in Maharashtra, that in USA you see that Mexicans are filling up the jobs, or closer home you see certain political parties in Maharashtra saying that they want to drive communities out because they feel that they're taking over the jobs. But in this, you also mentioned that there's a structural mismatch. So do you think that the argument of, let's say, Donald Trump or these political parties stands, or is it sort of unjustified?
I'm not going to justify or not justify what Mr. Trump does. just to say that there are similarities always across in the migration space. So whether it is Mexico you're looking at or Maharashtra closer home, there are these structural issues that come up. And it's really interesting, even with high-skilled workers, and we were trying to figure this out, and we asked some of them that, you know, how come Indians end up doing so many of these jobs. And why is it that the locals don't? Don't they see that this is where it's going and they could do these jobs? And an Indian, software engineer replied saying, do you know that sometimes we don't get to sleep at night? Do you know that sometimes the client will call us at some hour because there is some problem that needs to be solved? And the Indians are willing to do some of this work and not some of the others. And they don't want these jobs. And this is why you find this happening very often as well.
So I'm Himanshu. I'm also from National Law School. When we talk about migration policy, the foreign relations issue come into picture. And considering that we have different relations with different countries, is it really feasible for India to have a uniform migration policy? Normatively, I believe that we should treat everyone equally, but is it really feasible, considering that we have different relations with Pakistan and different with Sri Lanka or Myanmar? So
would you like to direct your question to someone in particular?
No, the panel. I think Gurucharan sir.
First of all, it's very difficult to have a generic migration policy. There are different instruments that are used. One is a bilateral instrument. You know, you could have a labor mobility partnership with a particular country. You could have a regional process which would be covering the countries, an instrument which covers the countries in the region. Or you could have a multilateral instrument. But what I was trying to emphasize was that while you have a multilateral architecture which is rule-based and binding for goods and services, there isn't such architecture for mobility of people. And you know, clearly, if you look at the demographics of the world, migration is going to be absolutely essential if the, what I would call the Darwinian Malthusian dynamic has to work, because there's too much of a demographic deficit in certain parts of the world and too much of a demographic so-called dividend on the surpluses on the other side. So the problem is structural. There has to be mobility. And it's my personal belief that the next frontier of globalization is going to be mobility of people, deterritorialization of skills, and this right-wing swing that is taking place wherever, in India, in America, in Britain, and this one, I think is a passing phase. I mean, the structural compulsions of global economic growth, I think. Also, unfortunately, there's been a retreat of Western liberalism also, you know. So it's a passing phase in my view. And I think we will be looking soon at a regime which will provide for freer mobility and greater human rights for people based on residence rather than citizenship.
Just to clarify, were you speaking about the general global migration management regime, or do you mean just specifically for India, whether we should have a...
Specifically for India. I mean, like, normatively we are talking about that they should be there, but is it really feasible? Can this happen? Like, sir talked about...
It is eminently feasible. For instance, India already has some bilateral instruments which enable, for example, social security coordination with the EUMS. I think we have about 15 or 16 bilateral agreements for social security coordination. This is a very important instrument, for example, because it prevents double payment of social security for detached workers. It provides for totalization benefits. It provides for repatriation of contributions. It provides for payment of pension outside your country of employment. So there are many benefits. And currently it's a bilateral instrument. But now, we are even probably the European Union, as well as many other countries, are beginning to look at combining human mobility partnerships with social security agreements at a multilateral level, which means, for example, there could be one instrument between India and the EU, which governs both mobility, portability of skills, as well as social security coordination. This is just one example. Another example is that we have bilateral MOUs on labor mobility for the protection of Indian workers in the Gulf countries, GCC countries. Many of them are individual. We have one with the UAE, we have one with Kuwait, and so on and so forth. It's not inconceivable that in the future we might think of having an India-GCC kind of an instrument which provides for some synergy and commonalities. So, I mean, it depends on how optimistic you are about the future of liberal democracy. But I think the right-wing forces are going to be defeated. So there will be opportunities for...
Yeah. Just to add the part about, your question on how difficult is it to have, but then, that's true for any other thing, but we have guidelines for that, then why not for this? For everything, there'll always be diversity, there'll always be varied considerations to make, but what's important is to have, especially in terms of migration, is to have the basic minimum policy set in stone. It's so important to even the basic principle about acknowledging that there are people, non-Indians or non-citizens, also belong to certain other categories. That itself is missing right now. It's even missing from the judicial discourse, what you were talking about. Even there is no document that I can look at and say, oh yeah, okay, these are the kind of, different migrants or irregular, these are the categories. There's nothing. So at least those things need to be there.
And I think your point about different political considerations and therefore different kinds of migration relations is well taken. That's true, but that's true for all countries. I mean, there are Indians get visas to certain countries much faster than they get visas to other countries. So let's not forget that we keep talking about, migration regime, legal regime, but there are actual people sitting there implementing laws. So when you take your passport and go to an embassy for a visa and you get it and another person doesn't get it, in the end, it is you at the center of that. You have a certain, you know, a qualification, there are certain criteria that you have to meet. What we are asking is for those criteria to be set. So there's nothing wrong in setting those criteria and then leaving the field open to see who meets it or who we want to accept on those criteria. But the difference in those political considerations or relations with countries is not a grounds to not have those criteria at all for certain countries. Any other questions? There's one here and then. I think we have about 5 minutes for questions and then we'd like to wind up. Thank you.
Hello, I am Shomabha and I'm pursuing my LLM in the National Law School. So my question is specifically to all the three panelists and to ma'am also. Ma'am, firstly to Sita, ma'am, don't you think that the aspect of the Bangladeshis and the Nepalese depend also on which part of India we're talking about? Because I come from a state which is closer to Bangladesh. So probably in the sociocultural context, the integration of it would be more towards the Bangladeshi refugees, migrants, as compared to the Nepalese. So ma'am, that's a question for you. Ma'am, for you, I was working with International Justice Mission last October, and I felt that the problem is all the more with the minors, because even within the IPC, when they're trafficked, the minority depends under Section 373, 374. So there is a determination aspect, and what happens to them while this transition is happening. So ma'am, in your experience, do you have any sort of account which you can share with us where minor and that minor after being trafficked becoming a major, any experience in that regard? Also, I feel that I was interning at the Ministry of External Affairs, and I realized one thing, that the bureaucrats sitting there, there's a difference with their opinion and their understanding with the ones heading that. Because heading in the government, because I remember while I was working there, our Home Minister had gone on record to term the Rohingya refugees as economic migrants. And whereas we understood, and as I was speaking to Dr. Luther Rangreji, at that point of time, the director at the Legal Entities Division, he said that obviously we understand that they are not economic migrants, but they are refugees. So don't you think that there's this lacuna and in the legislature and the executive? So don't you think there's a huge lacuna and that creates a huge problem in the practical effectuation of this entire discourse? And finally, one question that is kind of bothering some of us who are pursuing our LLM in human rights is the understanding that there is something called deep ecology, and radical deep ecology talks about the natural resources and resources in general, which are not in proportion to the population. So while we're talking about resources being not in proportion to the population of a country in itself, how can, so this is not being pessimistic, but this is just some inquisitiveness, how can we take in more people from other countries when we are ourselves suffering from such a problem? And radical deep ecology talks about reduction of population as quickly
I think
as
I'm
possible.
Going to have to stop you. Because that's already four questions. Well beyond the one question limit. I will take one more question, and then I think we're going to have to answer all five. So.
No, so this is the final question we're taking.
My question is about the anti-trafficking bill that came out recently. So the bill has created a new category of offense called aggravated trafficking, which has then been defined to include encouraging or abetting any person to migrate illegally into India. So my question is, what implications would this conflation of smuggling with trafficking would have on migrant policy in India and the rights of migrants?
I don't want to say no to the last question, so I'll just take it anyway. Maybe we can cover it. You want to just, yeah.
I heard that you believe in boundless world and human rights on residence and not on citizenship. I feel somewhat it is utopian or idealistic. There are practical difficulties to it. How you comment on this? Only that is a question.
Thank you. Do you want to go first?
Mm,
but I'll answer the integration. Sure, integration is easier if there are other commonalities, whether they are language, whether they are any other issues. And that's true, and that's, I agree. I mean, there's nothing to it. Of course, if you could integrate in spaces which are easier culturally, everyone's life is easy for both those who are coming as well as those who are hosting them. So yeah, integration would be simpler if it is in the same place. It's not often the case because markets don't work like that. Yeah. But if it could be, sure, it would be simpler.
Yeah. Having said that, the NRC is a huge exercise. I mean, if there was so much integration closer to the border with Bangladesh, we wouldn't be having that exercise. It's, quite obviously, there's a lot of migration politics in that, obviously. Migration not just now, but from 80 years back, 70 years back. So integration is something that one has to facilitate. Integration is not always natural. Like we were discussing, there are lots of differences in the cultural makeup of India, religious things, I mean, with our border countries. So we are more receptive to certain migrants, depending on our own composition. Demographic composition, then we are to certain, and that again, that puts your whole thing on integration in certain areas into question.
So in terms of experience, I can understand that if you were the IJM, you would have dealt with a lot of people who are trafficked. One thing to talk about today is the fact that, so MHA has an advisory which says that any women or children who are found